Watch Hump Day with Hampshire. Have some fun before we retire. Take a little break from the quagmire. It's Hump Day with Hampshire.
Such a huge fan of my next guest. She has broken so many barriers in the entertainment industry. She is the first trans woman of color to have a leading role on a major scripted show. She's the first openly transgender person on the cover of Time magazine. She's been nominated for a Primetime Emmy, won a Daytime Emmy, and she has a wax figure in Madame Tussauds Museum. So she's super talented, a singer, a dancer, an actress. Her new film, Disclosure, Trans Lives on Film, comes out on Netflix this Friday. You know her best as Sophia from Orange is the New Black. Laverne Cox.
Oh my God, hello. Oh, I'm full screen. Give me a second, okay.
Oh, you look gorgeous.
Thank you. I couldn't do a full glam thing today. I just couldn't be bothered. So but I have my hairstylist Kaya right before quarantine. Interestingly enough, I asked her to wash and condition about 25 wigs. And I've worn this one once. So I've worn this one once in quarantine and I danced around a lot of it.
I didn't realize the wig. So
thank you.
That's like a great wig.
Thank you.
Conditioned.
I say really quickly, yeah. I'm obsessed with your theme song. I had not heard it before, Jeffrey.
Right?
I love your voice, Jeffrey. It's so amazing. Work.
At the end of the show, but also like that was maybe the highlight of my career. That theme song. The second highlight of my career is probably you. You're like my dream guest, like up there with SpongeBob SquarePants for this show.
Why am I your dream guest? Tell me why.
Because I think especially for this show, I think that Black trans women are a super vulnerable group, and I think you are such an inspiration to so many people. I mean, aside from all of that, I just like think you're awesome.
Thank you.
And everything, but I just think you have so much to offer and to say to people that I think the world could use now.
Thank you.
Why, I mean, I could go on forever.
That's really sweet. I appreciate that. Thank you.
But also I feel like, so in my intro, I mentioned intersectionality and I didn't know about it, which I'm embarrassed to admit. But I feel like you can speak to that obviously a zillion times better than I can. So
intersectionality, it's funny. I've been talking about intersectionality for a really long time. And it really is based, as you said, it means being at the intersection of multiple identities, potentially multiple oppressions. Most of us have intersectional identities, right? I'm Black, I'm trans, I'm a woman, but I'm also from the South and I'm an actress. And so identity is like, I'm American, you know? I'm still quarantining, like you. I've like not left the house in a week and a half. I'm like, okay. So we all sit at the intersections of multiple identities. And when those identities are marginalized, like being a person of color or being trans, then you're at the intersections of multiple oppressions. And so it's not that I experience just racism, I experience sexism, I also experience transphobia, and the double, triple binds of those intersections can create really uniquely specific challenges. One thing I would love to say about intersectionality is that the woman who coined the term intersectionality is a woman named Kimberly Crenshaw. She is a Black woman, feminist lawyer, and she the concept of intersectionality existed basically when Black feminism sort of came into being, when just Sojourner Truth in 1851, said, "Ain't I a woman?" She was talking about being at the intersection of being Black and a woman when both her Blackness and her womanhood were being denied. So what Kimberly Crenshaw observed, particularly in some of the legal cases that inspired her to come up with the term intersectional, is that particularly Anita Hill and women like her were not just experiencing sexism and not just experiencing racism, but the specific way that Black women experienced racism and sexism with its own unique thing, right? So yeah. We needed a new word to help us understand that specific way. She said that there's a woman named Polly Murray. Well, woman, because Polly Murray may have been trans, but Polly Murray, I just found out about Polly Murray like a year ago. Polly Murray was a lawyer and then an Episcopal minister who wrote what Thurgood Marshall calls the Bible for Brown versus Board of Education. And Polly Murray was assigned female at birth, African-American, went to Howard University, and for their dissertation wrote what Thurgood Marshall called the Bible for Brown versus Board of Education, which is basically the Bible for the civil rights movement.
Oh my God.
And Kimberly Crenshaw said that she came up with the idea of intersectionality from Polly Murray, someone who struggled with their identity as being attracted to other women, and then also back in the 1950s had written to different doctors about potentially transitioning to become a man. Polly Murray, who a lot of people don't know about, someone who had transgender thoughts at the very least, had attraction to other women and they were assigned female at birth, wrote the Bible for Brown versus Board of Education and came up with the idea for intersectionality. She called Jim Crow Jane Crow. Basically that Black women, again, experienced racism in a very different way from Black men. I just went off.
Fascinating though, like I don't think most people know about it. I never heard of her, and I think that's so fascinating that like at that time also, was she openly trans?
No. And this is only something we found out. There's a new book called Jane Crow about Polly Murray where we finally found all the letters that Polly wrote during their lifetime when they wrote letters to doctors about getting access to hormone therapy. And then sort of the notes about how Polly struggled with their sexuality. It's something that we didn't know until just a few years ago.
Oh my God, I want to read that.
Interesting, amazing, fascinating. Jane Crow is the book, and it is really, it's riveting. So trans, we can't say trans the way we say it now, but what we do know is that Polly had thoughts about at least taking testosterone at the very least, and certainly was attracted to women and struggled with that.
Oh my God. I feel like this has obviously been a difficult time, but I am a silver linings person, and I feel like there's so much good that has come out of this in terms of like, we're hearing names we didn't know about that we should know about. Yeah. Also, so I usually like to play a game on my show, but then you brought up something that I thought would be so amazing to do on the show, and you haven't done it yet, which is real bad.
Okay.
Fill out your census.
Yes. Thank you so much. And I was going to do it a few weeks ago, and then I was told that today is National Census Day.
Oh, it is? June 17th.
It is National Census Day. So I was planning to fill out my census anyway. So if anyone wants to join us, we're live. Yes. People are watching us.
Yes.
We are live and in color. So if you go to my 2020census.gov, okay. my 2020census.gov, let me know when you're there.
Okay.
And you can do it together.
Oh, wait, my turn. Okay. My
2020, and the number 2020, census.gov.
2020 census.gov. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. I'm here.
Gorgeous. Okay, cool. So I haven't done this yet, but I'm assuming start questionnaire. So I'm clicking start questionnaire. Do you see start questionnaire?
Yeah.
Let's do it. Okay.
Oh my God.
Where can I find my 12-digit census ID? I don't know. Use materials we mailed to you or left at your door. All the information that you provide will remain confidential. So there has to be another way. I don't have that right now. We may not be able to do this right now. I have to find do you have the thing that they mailed to you? There has to be another way. I do not have a census ID. Click here. Let's see.
Oh, I mean, I have the thing that, okay.
Okay, in order to collect your address, we first need to know where you were living on April 1st, 2020. Please select where you were living on April 1st, 2020. I think maybe they're going to retrieve our ID for us. I don't know.
Okay.
U.S. state or District of Columbia. Yes. So I'm going to put next. And then are you with me?
I'm here. Yeah.
Where were you living on April 1st, 2020? Okay. Please provide a complete street address for your residence. Provide the street address you would use to have a package delivered directly to your residence, not a rural route or P.O. box address used for mailing purposes. A street address is the most helpful. Okay, I'm not going to say my address out loud.
That was why I wanted to do the census. I wanted to get your street address. Okay, I did fill out the thingy. I filled it out and I think I have it. Here. I have it here. And so I filled mine out online, but.
Okay, cool.
I noticed because you were coming on the show and said you wanted to fill out your census, I never thought of my census in any other way than that's not true. I was gonna say as a white cis female, but then it's like I've suddenly seen it change into you can put same sex husband, wife, spouse, or there's been updates and stuff.
Same sex wife, hold up. This is news to me. If you can actually claim a same-sex partner on the census?
Yes, that's new right here, same-sex, this is very new, which I thought was great. However,
but only if you have a partner.
Partner?
But only if you have a partner, is that what it is?
Oh, yes, or same-sex unmarried partner.
Oh, in terms of who you live with or your romantic partner?
How is the person related to you?
Well, what's gagging me about this is that in 2016, I went to Washington, D.C. to help amplify the LGBTQ Data Inclusion Act, which was a bill that it introduced in 2016 that didn't really go anywhere in Congress that would add LGBTQ folks to the 2020 census. That bill never went anywhere. And then there was a concerted effort from this current administration to not have trans people and gay and lesbian people counted in the census. And so I'm seeing this and I'm shook.
Well, but they aren't, because in terms of gender, there are two boxes. There is a male box and a female box. And that was what really surprised me. And then someone told me, actually our producer of this show told me, because I was like, there's no other, what about non-binary? What about this is the census, you know, how you identify, I think is important. And he said that there is a hack online that when you go into gender, if you keep pushing the thing, trans will come up. I don't know if that's true.
Oh,
that's crazy that you have to use a hack to put how you identify.
Well, this is all news to me. I did not know this. This is actually kind of encouraging that you can hack in and put trans somehow.
Well, I mean, that's sad that that's encouraging though. I think we can go.
No, because we fought. I mean, I think data is so important. The census is so important. I'm going to continue filling out. What is your name and telephone number? So the census is so important because if you are not counted, you can be discounted. How we allocate funds over the next 10 years is going to depend on this census data that we're filling out right now. And if there's an undercount, a lot of people are going to be left out of the equation, right? And not really be represented. How resources are allocated, how our congressional districts are drawn are gonna be based on this census, on who we elect to state legislatures this year. So the census is really, really, really important around having justice for everybody, justice for all.
Yeah, and this kind of really says it, that the only people counted in this are cis male and cis female. Those are your options, at least on this. So that means you're discounted when it comes to all those state legislation. So, I mean, I didn't know about that. I'm so glad you brought that to my attention, just even doing the census.
And this is why elections have consequences. If we had had a different president and a different administration, perhaps there wouldn't have been a concerted effort. We may have been able to get questions about gender, transgender status, there being LGBTQI+ onto this census, but this administration quashed it and had nothing, wanted nothing to do with counting us. And again, when you don't count us, then we don't have access to resources. We don't actually, all the numbers that we have about the number of transgender people who exist in the United States are guesstimations from the Williams Institute. So they've taken various different surveys from different states and made a guesstimation. We don't actually know because we don't have the census data.
Yeah. This is huge. You know what's great? My next guest is Sarah Kate Ellis, who is the president.
Yes.
I'm gonna ask some things that we can maybe do about this. I wish I could fill out the census with you all day and talk to you all day, but I have to, I'm getting little things like that. I have to go, but before
it's all good. But we started it, and I'm probably going to continue it on Instagram Live. So if people want to come and join it, they should continue watching your show. But then I'm going to go on Instagram Live and continue to fill out my census. This has been glorious meeting you this way.
I have so many more questions. I have 3 pages of questions for you. It's really embarrassing. But before you go, I want to give you on this show. I usually give people their quarantine nickname, but now I'm doing the quarantine nickname, which is your emotional state, your current emotional state, and the last thing you ate. So, for example, mine would be like obsessed salami.
My current emotional state, serene bacon.
That's good.
Serene bacon. Literally, I was eating the bacon before we started.
Oh, that's good. That looks like good bacon.
It's good. It's really good.
Laverne, I washed my hands of you. This is because I washed my hands to get to the next, so I don't spread.
I have hand sanitizer too. So hey.
Okay. Thank you so much for coming on the show.
This was glorious.
Who is the casting director who cast you in the show and is a friend of mine. And I was like, please, please. So thank you.
My pleasure. You are delightful. Have a wonderful rest of show. And we'll talk soon, hopefully.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye, darling.